RSVP to Heart Blood Bay. I see you up there lighting fires. I got an invitation to the Fireman's Ball. I saw you up there lighting fires. I took a wrong turn by a burning tree. I saw you up there lighting fires. It was you up there lighting fires. Underneath the cross by Calvary, I saw you up there lighting fires. What you do, I'll give it to you straight. Hope it pulls you through. Cotton and nails, hammer and sickle. Steal yourself a riverboat and fill it up with nickel.
That was Lighting Fires, which is the opening track on the second solo album from G.W. McLennan. Fireboy is the title. And Grant, or G.W., is here with us. Grant, you're very welcome to the programme. Is it Grant or G.W.? You better sort of...
Dave.
The last time you were here was Grant.
Dave, you've known me for a long time, so you can call me Grant.
Thank you very much. Okay, Grant, a long time indeed. You were with us on the programme back in 86 when you were with the Go-Betweens, and you were with us on the programme towards the end of the Go-Betweens, when you supported REM, when they played in Dublin in the summer of, it was either 89 or 90. It was 89, was it? Okay. So what's been happening since then? There's a couple of things, right? I mean, a couple of things that we know about, which is solo albums and also Jack Frost. Just take us through the end of the Go-Betweens.
There's not a lot to say, because it wasn't as though I sat around, you know, in a lighthouse for months thinking about my decision. All I knew is I'd spoken to Amanda Brown and said, you know, well, I asked her what she thought about if I would sort of leave the Go-Betweens, and she thought it was an interesting idea, and then I kind of shelved it and thought it was in the is the phrase the too hard basket. So towards the end of 89, I was also incredibly exhausted from about 18 months solid touring. We'd toured the world twice and then done the REM world tour, so it was like I was just completely and utterly exhausted. I was very tired of working in a group. Not working with those people, but tired of working in a group. And I wanted to sort of say something or write something and do it immediately and not have to justify it or rule by consensus or, you know, anything like that. So it was a number of reasons. And I also think, subconsciously, I've heard a tape of the last two Go-Between shows, which we did in Sydney with a new bass player, new songs. We were rehearsing for a record which we never made, and they are fascinating. And I sound like Robert. Robert sounds like me. I don't think that was very healthy. So, New Year, 1990, it was over.
Okay, well, now, first of all, just for those who need to be filled in, the Robert you're talking about is, of course, Robert Forster. And it came to the point where, like, on some albums, you'd write five songs, he'd write five songs or whatever, and it was always the two of you. And I'd say even a lot of Go-Betweens fans didn't necessarily know who was who or which was which. I remember having to ask you the last time, Bachelor Kisses, I really needed to know my favourite Go-Between song, who was it, and it was you, and this sort of thing. I wasn't even sure of that sort of thing, and yet I considered the Go-Betweens one of my favourite bands of the 1980s. So when you say that there was certain problems or that you didn't want to be in a band because of what it does, even though you got on very well with each individual, does it come to the point where tempers get frayed or where the muse doesn't really come, or you need to sort of have a reinvention, or you really, really need to go away? Because no matter how good it might be in terms of getting on with the people, being in a band just stops somewhere. You reach a wall.
I was still getting letters from the muse quite a lot, so it wasn't as though I'd been struck off the mailing list.
Right, yeah.
But it was basically a tiredness with the form. I was had been writing songs for a long time, and they were immediately moulded into the Go-Betweens form, which most of the time I was completely happy with and thought was wonderful. No complaints whatsoever. I agree with you. I think the Go-Betweens were a very fine group. But I also, there were other things I wanted to do. I wasn't too sure what they were. But I knew that I had some songs which the band really weren't doing the way I thought they should have been done. And that was kind of the first time that I ever really felt that. You know, there were occasional arguments, as always when people are close, you know. I think, to use a Hollywood cliche, I think that's really healthy. but...
but it really was healthy. Yeah.
But you know, I think also maybe I was seeing what was happening in Eastern Europe, you know, with all the old dictatorships falling, and I was kind of a little sorry. So I thought I'd basically put the democracy of the Go-Betweens up against the wall and call in the firing squad. And it wasn't just my opinion, because I spoke to Robert, and he had been thinking the same thing. So it just seemed... I mean, he and I started a band as sort of complete immature sort of boys, and we made six or seven albums and did everything we wanted to do. And when we started the band, it was just a two-piece, you know, and then slowly people joined over the years. Mm. So it was like, it was almost like, you know, we had named the child, given birth to it, and it was time for it to grow up and leave. And I think it was the best decision that we made.
Okay, well, before we actually go to the new album now, which is a solo album, let's take a track then from the Go-Betweens, one of my favourites, which is a track called The Wrong Road. Betweens, we're talking
beautiful
to G.W. McLennan. Brilliant.
I haven't heard that for such a long time.
A Trader in Furs.
I haven't heard that for such a
Living in Exile.
That's one of Robert's, yeah, Robert.
Yeah, I know
Robert
that,
really
yeah.
Like. No, that's one of my songs.
I know that too,
but
yeah.
Robert... I don't know what you know, but...
No, but seriously...
Whatever you know, you know.
What I wanted to get to was this literate side of the way of writing songs, that there is sort of... There seems to be that it never seems to be able to marry with some sort of commercial success. I mean, this is one of your great songs, one of the best songs written, say, of the 1980s, along with Bachelor Kisses, say, and a few others I can easily mention. And you just said there that you could easily have gone solo, or like, I mean, or maybe it was a time to do something different. You mentioned Democracy, Eastern Europe and all the rest of it. Mm. But isn't there a point as well that if you had brought out a seventh or eighth album or whatever it is from the Go-Betweens with songs that you had written, that maybe nobody yet again would buy it, because the Go-Betweens are the most successful band in terms of critical success,
yeah,
and were one of the least successful in terms of commercial success.
Yes.
So it's time to maybe put it into a different context, thus solo career.
Okay, yeah, I agree. But that Devil's Pact happened from about the second album onwards. So it was always, there was always the record company saying, or critics saying, this is the one, this is the one. And that got tedious after a while. I mean, I don't want to hear that. All I want to hear is that they believe the record and want to do something with it, or understand it, or feel it, you know. So that just got tiresome. Also, success... I think the Go-Betweens are an immensely successful band. We did exactly what we wanted to do 24 hours a day. Not many bands can say that. So that to me is being true to, without being, you know, portentous or about it. It was everything we set out to achieve, we did, and we didn't actually ever think about number one. You know, we would have been happy with number 45.
Sure, but after a while, isn't it a bit of a pain in the neck to have to, for instance, have seven record labels and about four albums? I mean, that's not very healthy either.
Oh, that was horrible, because you always had to learn everyone's name.
No, that's not really what I meant, actually. But actually, that's another problem about it, yeah. But it is a bit of a pain that after a while, like it's nice to be able to think that there's enough people out there, or maybe that it's building up all the time in terms of the recognition. And it wasn't necessarily building up in some ways. Okay, it was building up slowly, but maybe not quick enough.
Well, actually, I think 16 Lovers Lane was easily the most successful Go-Betweens record, and had been played on whatever commercial radio is, or was then, and was played a lot, and a very popular record. And we could have kept on touring that, because REM asked us to go with them again to America for the autumn tour of Green, and we just said no, you know, because we needed to record again, and we were just tired, you know. I think we could have continued. That record would have done even better, and I think probably if we'd made another record, probably, you know, would have been the one. Yeah. But I just didn't want to play that game.
Yeah.
Fatigue had set in.
Well, that fatigue that had set in, it's a bit of a slice of history time as well, because REM since then have become so incredibly huge, and that was the last tour they ever did. Well, that was the last tour they've done.
Yeah, well,
so far.
They toured with the Go-Betweens.
Indeed. Indeed. Quite true, they did. Yeah. So it was a good fun touring with REM.
Oh, it was
They were in a good mood at the time. Yeah,
yeah, they're wonderful boys, yeah, or men. Yeah. Wonderful musicians, very humorous, intelligent, responsible, crazy.
And they love their music, don't
and
they?
And they love their music, and it's everything to them. And their respect for the fan, for their fans, is great. And it was easily, along with a tour that the Go-Betweens did with the birthday party in the early 80s, easily the most enjoyable tours with other people I've ever done.
Yeah. Okay, well then, what about collaborations since? I mean, one of the things at the end of the Go-Betweens was Jack Frost, and that was with Steve Kilby from The Church. And that's two pretty famous sort of down under bands and main guys coming together. That was pretty good. I mean, was that just a whim?
That was a complete and utter whim on Stephen's part. The Killer phoned me up, and he got back from the Gold Afternoon Fix tour in America, and I think he was bored, and he'd gone through his phone book, and no one was home, but I just happened to be home, and maybe he might have rung up Kylie Minogue, you know, and she would have said yes. And but he said, do you want to write a song? And we'd only met a couple of times in New York, and at a party. I'd seen The Church play, and they'd listened to the Go-Betweens records and stuff. And it seemed like an interesting idea, because I was bursting with melody at that stage and was just about to record watershed, so there was about 2 weeks to go. Steve came around, we wrote, didn't know where I was that afternoon, and knew that that was a fun thing, you know, sort of trashy, stonesy, throwaway, but a lot of fun. And he said, let's go and record it. And I said, oh, well, I've kind of got to do this record. And he said, oh, it won't take much time. We went into the studio and he said, let's make an album. And I thought, okay, I was in the studio. And from then on, every day we would come into the studio with not knowing what we were going to do. And we'd say, what are we going to do today? And I might say, well, let's do a 3/4 song beginning with strings with a sort of Baroque feel. He'd go, yeah, I like that. So we'd write a song like that.
Right. Okay, well, let's take a track from the album then, Jack Frost. This is called Thought That I Was Over You. Over You is the title, Jack Frost. That's Steve Kilby with G.W. McLennan, and we are here live in the programme too with Grant, as I'm allowed to call him. You can have to call him that. Stick with the old G.W. as it says on the cover. That first album did come out then, Watershed. The title, I mean, it's an obvious question, but is that what it is or was to you?
I think in retrospect it probably was. But when I named the record, I wasn't thinking about the significance of what watershed means. I was merely struck, quite honestly, by the marriage of the word water with the word shed. I just loved the sound of it. It sounded to me like a train moving in the night. Watershed, watershed, watershed. So I had a purely kind of audio attraction to it. And then, after I realised that I was indeed going to call it that, and that there'd been the gap after the Go-Betweens and being solo, I love the name, but it's caused me a few problems.
Why?
Because I don't necessarily see it as a watershed. Mm. You know, I mean, I in some way see the Jack Frost record as a watershed, because on that record I tried everything, you know, differently as possible. There's the spoken word, there's electro, there's high energy, there's rock and roll like Thought That I Was Over You, there's Velvets inspired stuff, there's a conga song, there's, you know, so it, that to me was like adventure and just trying all the things I could never have or felt that I couldn't do in the Go-Betweens. So in some way, that was like a bursting. And then I went straight into my record and I was recording Watershed in the first week and mixing Jack Frost as well.
Did it change your approach to songwriting?
It hasn't changed my approach to the way I write songs, but it's made me aware that there are, many other ways to write songs.
Because you once said, I think, in the first interview, I can't remember if it was 86 or if it was 89, you said something along the lines of that you could never write a song like Always On My Mind or something like that. That even though you think all your songs are love songs, you can't talk about, say, Mary and Johnny walking down the road. You talk about, like, did they have coffee for breakfast that morning or what might be in her handbag or something like that. Is that the way it's still got to be for Grant McLennan? Is that why you stand out? Is that why you're not commercially successful,
yeah,
maybe?
Well, I mean, obviously, I think part of it's to do with the language I use. So yeah. I think that's a very fair question. I mean, a lot of songs on the radio, even the ones I like, a lot of the language is very familiar language. It's not that I avoid familiar language. You know, I talk as anyone else does. But when I come to write, I'm interested in the, you know, this is where I kind of go off, you know, I'm disappearing in my head now. But I kind of want to write the lovely, minute moments where two people or who have something or might be losing something or are about to get something or want to have something, that little spark, it's almost like I can see the tear fall. I can see the way the hair turns on the back of the head, you know, when they just move. The luster of the skin. And those kind of things, it's not essentially pop, I'm aware of that. It's more, I guess, in a way, poetic, for want of a better word. I'm very interested in that. But also of late, because I've already written the songs for the next record, which I've never kind of been in this position before, that one's just about to come out or hasn't quite come out, and I've already got the next one. So I'm in this strange position, but I know that the language already is much... It just gets more and more simple. I mean, I'll probably get around to say Johnny and Mary walking down the street, you know, gonna meet their baby.
Yeah, I mean, but at the same time, like the songs that you have written in the way you've just described there, I mean, there aren't that many people doing that, and we don't necessarily need any more people writing about going down the street. Not that I won't allow you to do that, I won't still like any subsequent record, but it's just that we could do it a few more of the things I'm talking about here, you know?
Well, I'm honoured that you think that I do it, so thanks, Dave, that's very nice.
Yeah, well, that's true. Okay, well, let's just talk about this new album then with some of the tracks on this. You mentioned something earlier on, which I've forgotten what I was going to say, some phrase that you used, and I mean, when we're talking about the elements of fire, water, sun, moon, these are the kind of things that crop up in your writing quite a lot, right?
They do, but I have to actually plead an ignorance there, because after Watershed came out, and there was a very good Australian songwriter and a great friend of mine called Paul Kelly, and he...
Paul Kelly and the Messengers.
Yeah, and he... performed on a couple of the songs on Watershed, and he said, I listened to the lyrics, and he said, do you know how that you talk about the moon and the sun, you know, like 50 times or, you know, or 42 times, he probably counted it, knowing Paul. And I said, no, I didn't realize. So the language that you use, you're not often aware of it, you know, you're probably not aware of what you say to your friends, and your little touchstones, the clues into you, and it's only when someone points them out. So I'm in a position that I write things and people point them out to me. So sometimes that can make me a little self-conscious, whereas most people don't have that happening to them. You know, people go, oh, right, you know, we understand what he's saying. On Fireboy, I'm aware that it's a lot more... heat, and that's because I feel as though I'm a lot more optimistic, and that I can actually see the way ahead. I'm nowhere near as lost in the forest as I was on Watershed, so that makes me feel absolutely very happy, and that's why this record is so kind of important to me.
Okay, so what else makes you feel happy these days, Grant? I mean, you don't want a satellite dish, you want a river in which to fish or whatever, right?
Yeah.
Is that what it is, in a nutshell?
Well, that's...
The house on the hill.
Yeah, that's when I close my eyes, which is the name of the song as well, but that's more an imagining, you know, a gentle imagining. And that song actually, what's interesting about it is it was the last song I wrote for the record, and I wrote it in Los Angeles at the end of the Lloyd Cole tour, and I knew that it belonged on the record, even though it's got a lot more to do with the new songs that I've got. So it's a clue for me as well that that's kind of what's going to happen.
The first single from the album is Fingers.
Well, let me talk about Fingers.
Yeah.
Can I talk about Fingers?
Yeah.
Fingers was a song which the English record label thought was like a different and lovely song to kind of introduce the record. I always thought it was more of a bold experiment than the obvious choice. And But I thought, you know, it was imaginative, so I thought they should do it. But what it meant is, I mean, Virgin in France, which is my label there, they were always going to go for Lighting Fires. In Australia, I wanted the single to be Around the World, the first single to be Surround Me, which I think is the, you know, one of the all-time, it's just good Grant songs.
But you can understand the Lighting Fires situation.
I can understand, but I thought that Lighting Fires would be a second single, and then maybe Bathe in the Waters of Love, third, you know. But so then it sort of turned around in about 2 or 3 weeks to Lighting Fires now in England, whereas in Belgium and Holland, Fingers is out and is being played everywhere. You know, I did 40 interviews in those two countries, you know?
Yeah. And you were always big in those countries. People always remember. I mean, is there a question that maybe you weren't as big in the States as you might have been, and that could have helped?
Oh, without a doubt, without a doubt. I mean, we toured America 3 or 4 times, but never really had the support of the record label, you know, like right behind you. You know, they loved what we did, but that we were the type of band, if someone rang up and said, hey, do you want to play Prague? You've got to drive 800 miles to get there. You've got to meet a guy with a raincoat on and a carnation, and his name's Joseph, and there's going to be machine guns everywhere, and it's illegal. Do you want to do it? Yes. So people took advantage of our Australian naivety and openness.
He said that with such sincerity, hand on heart. He had it off by heart, basically. Okay, well, now, Grant, this business of other things you've been doing in the last couple of years, like in between these two albums, you also did get back with Robert. This is now the aforementioned Robert Forster from the Go-Betweens. You got back with him to tour, what, acoustically with Lloyd Cole or something?
Yes, it was a mixture of a couple of things, because Robert Vickers, the Go-Betweens' old bass player, was now Lloyd's bass player. We had met Lloyd in New York, and he was very fond of some of the things that we were fond of, you know, like gin and, you know, pepper vodka, and he and Robert could talk about golf. And it just seemed to be an interesting thing to do, because I hadn't planned to tour Europe with Watershed, because I wasn't in the mood for touring. I've already discussed that. I wanted to do another record and then maybe do it with a bit more behind me. And Robert had only played in... he played some shows in Germany and London, I think, or England. So it seemed like a good way also for the Americans to see some of the songs of Watershed, some of the songs of Danger in the Past, Robert's solo, first solo record. And also the great love that Bobby and I have for each other and playing with each other. So it was just after the first night, it was just so easy and effortless to be playing on stage with Robert again.
Has he got a flourishing solo career himself since that album?
Well, he stayed in Germany for a while, and he moved back to Australia last year, and has just finished a new record called Calling from a Country Phone, and I've heard it, and it's got more in common with Lee Remick and Karen
from the very early days.
From the very early days, than Danger in the Past, because it was recorded in the same studio that we did Lee Remick and Karen, and I like it very much.
Okay, well, I want to play a couple of tracks now. The aforementioned, as I said, this is about the fourth time we've used that word, from the Go-Betweens, from the Spring Hill Fair album, Bachelor Kisses, and then I'm going to play the final track on the Fireboy album by G.W. McLennan, who's here with us live, which is called Riddle in the Rain. So back after these two.
The chills, your bent dancer's feet, and I'm worrying about the bills. You rock and roll schoolgirl, you said the mechanism was fixed. You let your lips curl, it's funny how some things stick. Well, here it comes again. This riddle in the rain. been my wife. I guess there's some holes you don't fill. A genuine proposal, a shifting of skin, then a quick disposal to the cut-off bin. Well, here it comes again. This riddle in the rain. But I'm still a long way. I'm not even close. Tell me, who do I pay to get rid of your ghost? And 2 weeks in Lent, a time of denial, you deceptive innocent. Yes, I know this is final. And pipes can break, and milk can go sour, but I'm still waking up with aches at early morning hours. Well, here it comes again, this riddle in the rain. But I'm still a long way. I'm not even close. Tell me, who do I pay to get rid of? By pictures of a hospital bed, drips, cuts and stitches in your shaking head. A necessary performance, maybe an exorcism. I never did see a dance. Is this what it's like in prison? Well, here it comes again, pretty slow. I wanna know, is there another arrow in the bow? Well, here it comes again, this riddle in the rain. But I'm still a long way. I'm not even close. Tell me, who do I pay to get rid of? Comes the twist, though you can't be traced, I still can't resist the distant burn of your face. And I'm back in Crete, it's a morgue of silence, but the sun's looking sweet, coming up over the island.
To playing live at all, Grant? You just
after I leave here tonight, I'm returning to Australia very soon, and I'm going to rehearse most of the characters, the desperados that were on Fireboy,
right.
Do a tour of Australia and New Zealand in March and April, and come back to Europe and Ireland in the summer with the electric tenderfoots, you know.
The Electric Tenderfoots. Maybe you'll play a live session for us in Studio 8 just across the corridor. Okay, well listen, G.W. McLennan, or Grant McLennan, the second album is out at the moment, Fireboy. Once again, congratulations. It's great stuff. I'm going to play that song I mentioned earlier, a single in some places. Fingers is the title. Grant, it's been a pleasure, needless to say, once again. Thanks a million.
Dave, I always look forward to meeting you, and thanks very much.
Thank you very much, Grant. Take it easy. Good luck. This is Fingers.
Watch me fall through your fingers.
I will spill away like sand. Hey, you, watch me fall through your fingers. Now you know what it's like to be a man.
Thinking of a career change? At Canada Life, we're looking for...